You are listening to Romans, an expositional commentary by R.C. Sproul, published by Ligonier Ministries. This book is read by William Sarris. Dedication. To my beloved St. Andrew's congregation in Sanford, Florida, who faithfully attend the exposition of Sacred Scripture. Preface. On the first page of Romans in my Greek Testament, I have scribbled at the top of the page a few significant dates. The first one is the year AD 386. In the latter part of the 4th century lived a young man whose father was a pagan and whose mother was a devout Christian. This young man had devoted himself to immorality. He had already sired one illegitimate son, yet his mother continued to pray for his soul and sought the counsel of her pastor, Bishop Ambrose of Milan. This young man was pacing one day in a garden where a copy of the New Testament was chained to a lectern. As he was walking, he overheard children playing in the grass, singing a refrain to one of their childhood games, Tole Lege, Tole Lege, which means take up and read. So this young man, whose name was Aurelius Augustine, went to the scriptures that were there. He allowed the volume of sacred writ to fall open where it would, and in the providence of God, it fell open to Romans chapter 13. Augustine's eyes fell on this passage. And do this, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Therefore, let us cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly, as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy. But put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lusts. Romans chapter 13, verses 11 through 14. As Augustine read these words, the Spirit of God took them and pierced between joint and sinew, bone and marrow, to the very depths of this young man's soul. By the power of the Word of God with the Spirit attending it, Augustine was converted to the Christian faith, and we know him today as Saint Augustine of Hippo. Later in church history, in 1515, an Augustinian monk who had diligently pursued his doctoral studies in the works of Augustine was consigned to a university to be the professor of biblical studies. He had already delivered his first series of lectures on the Book of Psalms, and now his task was to teach his students the Book of Romans. As he was preparing his lectures on Romans and studying this epistle's first chapter, he found a notation from an ancient manuscript of Augustine defining the righteousness of Christ. Augustine said that when Paul speaks of the righteousness of God in Romans chapter 1, it is not the righteousness by which God himself is righteous, but the righteousness that he freely gives to those who put their trust in Christ. For the first time in his life, Martin Luther, whose conscience had been wounded by the burden of the law of God that daily exposed his relentless guilt, understood the gospel of Christ. The doors of paradise swung open, and he walked through. And it was from Paul's teaching on the doctrine of justification by faith alone that Luther stood against the whole world in the 16th century Reformation. Another date I have scribbled in my Greek Testament is the year 1738, when a man who was already ordained to the ministry in the Anglican Church in England was listening to a message being delivered outside in London at Aldersgate. He mentioned later that as he was listening to the words of Romans, he felt his heart was strangely warmed. He said that was the moment of his authentic conversion, and it defined the life and ministry of John Wesley for the rest of his days. I could mention the impact of Romans on John Calvin, Jonathan Edwards, and a host of others throughout church history, but as we come to it now, I simply remind you that God has richly blessed those who have devoted themselves to the study of this book. Chapter 1. Greetings. Romans chapter 1 verses 1 through 7. Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ. To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The book of Romans begins with one word, Paul, verse 1. From the book of Acts, we are familiar with the trials and missionary activity of the Apostle Paul. He is well known to us. We consider him our mentor and friend. At the beginning of this letter, he follows a custom practiced regularly in his day. In antiquity, the author of an epistle usually identified himself by name at the beginning. Today we read, Dear Bill, or Dear John, or Dear Mary, then wait to the end of the letter to find out who wrote it. Paul does not depart from the old custom and identifies himself as the author of the epistle in the first word. Who was Paul? Paul starts by giving his name, but he then seeks to define who he understands himself to be. This self-identification is not just Paul's introspection or self-evaluation. The Holy Spirit superintends the apostle's writing, which is how we know that this is a true and accurate description of the author of the epistle. Paul identifies himself as a bondservant of Jesus Christ, verse 1. I have never been satisfied with that English translation of this second phrase. Some translations have, Paul, a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bondservant is an improvement, but I think the proper translation should read, Paul, a slave of Jesus Christ. The Greek word Paul used here is doulos. A doulos was not a hired servant who could come and go as he pleased. A doulos was a person who had been purchased, and once purchased, he became his master's possession. This idea of the doulos in Scripture is always connected to another descriptive word, kurios. If you have a Roman Catholic background, or if you know something of sacred music in church history and high church liturgy, you have heard of the Kyrie. Kyrie eleison, Christus eleison, Kyrie eleison. It means, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy, because the supreme title given to Jesus by the Father in the New Testament is the title Kyrios. Kyrios translates the Old Testament Adon or Adonai, which means the Sovereign One, a name in the Old Testament that was reserved for God. In the New Testament, the title Lord or Kyrios is used in three ways. There is a simple common usage where calling someone Kyrios is like addressing him as Sir, a polite form of address. The supreme use of Kyrios refers to the Sovereign God who rules all things. Kyrios, the name which is above every name, Philippians chapter 2, verse 9, is the name given to Jesus, whom the Father calls the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There is yet a middle usage of the term Kyrios in the New Testament. It is used to describe a slave owner, which is an apt description of Jesus, and it is from this that Paul describes himself. He is not just a servant, but a slave. Paul, in addressing believers, said, You are not your own, for you were bought at a price, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. We have been purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ, Acts chapter 20, verse 28. There is a paradox here. When the New Testament describes our condition by nature as fallen people, it describes us as slaves to sin. We are by nature in bondage to sin, bondservants of the flesh, and the only remedy for that, according to the New Testament, is to be liberated by the work of the Holy Spirit. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Everyone born of the Spirit is set free from slavery to sin. There is also irony here. When Christ sets us free from slavery to the flesh, he calls us to the royal liberty of slavery to him. That is why we call him Master. We acknowledge that it is from him that we get our marching orders. He is the Lord of our lives. We are not our own. We are not autonomous or independent. Unless people understand their relationship to Christ in these terms, they remain unconverted. Paul makes a significant affirmation about himself and his mission, called to be an apostle, verse 1. In the early chapters of Acts, the church gathered to elect a new apostle, and it set forth the criteria for apostleship. The first criterion was having been a disciple of Jesus during his earthly ministry. The second was having been an eyewitness of the resurrection. And the third and most important criterion was having been directly and immediately called by Jesus, Acts chapter 1 verses 20 through 26. On one occasion, Jesus sent out 70 disciples. There were far more disciples than the 12. Not all those who were disciples became apostles. We tend to use these words interchangeably, as if 12 disciples and 12 apostles must mean the same thing. But a disciple is simply a learner or a student. Jesus was the rabbi, and enrolled in his school were many disciples. From out of that group, he chose 12 to be elevated to the rank of apostle, those who were commissioned to speak for the master. In the ancient world, an apostle was like an ambassador who spoke on behalf of the king. The ambassador's message carried with it the authority of the one who sent him. The word apostolos in Greek means simply one who is sent. He who hears you hears me. He who rejects you rejects me. And he who rejects me rejects him who sent me, Luke chapter 10, verse 16. People often say, "I like to know what Jesus says. It is Paul I do not want to listen to." Almost all we know about Jesus is that which comes through apostolic authority, so such remarks set Paul against Matthew or Paul against John. That may not be done with impunity because all of the apostolic writings carry the delegated authority of Jesus himself. That is what it means to be an apostle. That is why the New Testament church is built on the foundation of the apostles. In the three criteria for apostleship, Paul fails the first two tests. He had not been a disciple of Jesus during Jesus' tenure on earth, nor had he been an eyewitness of the resurrection of Christ. That is why there were some in the early church who seriously challenged the apostolic authority of Paul. The supreme qualification for apostolic authority was a direct and immediate call by Jesus. I believe that is why, in the book of Acts, the account of Paul's conversion on the road to Damascus, where Christ called him to be his apostle, is repeated three times. It is to remind the people that Paul is an authentic agent of revelation. He speaks with the authority of Jesus. The next thing we learn about Paul is that he had been separated to the gospel of God, verse 1. In Latin, separated means segregated, set apart from the multitude to a specific, sacred, consecrated task. The phrase Paul uses involves a part of the speech in the Greek language called the genitive, which indicates possession. He is not saying, "I have been commissioned to announce a message or good news about God." Rather, he is saying that the gospel he has been separated and called to proclaim is God's gospel. God is the author and owner of it. Paul is simply the messenger whom God has called and set apart to proclaim to people a message that comes from God himself. If I said, "I have some great news for you," it would pique your interest. If I added, "This great news comes from God himself," you may think that I am unhinged. But if you thought for a moment that I was sober in such a statement, and that I did have a message from God himself, some good news, you would want to hear it. That is what Paul is saying before he spells out the doctrines of grace. He says, "I have been commissioned to proclaim God's gospel, the gospel that belongs to him. It is his possession, and I am going to communicate it to you." The promised gospel.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.